LGBTQI+ representative on the student council. So as I've been kind of in that role, I've been working with a variety of different groups around campus to kind of improve administrative kind of accommodations for transgender students in particular. As a trans student coming to UL from the US, I might as well add, I've kind of noticed that there are a lot of ways that UL in particular, but Ireland in general, are really, really wonderful and so supportive of trans students, but there's a couple places where we fall short. So I'm trying to kind of fill that gap and do as much work as I possibly can. So today I wanted to talk a little bit about what UL is doing and what they're doing really, really, really well, what more can we do, and to kind of present a little bit of a pie in the sky vision for what I hope for the future. Again, generated from the university I went to in the US was particularly, it's nationally known for its support of LGBT students. I can personally say I don't think I'd be out if I didn't go to that place first and have such a wonderful fostering community. And my goal is to have that for you out here. I think it's just so important and so necessary to have a welcoming and fostering kind of community. So here are some of my ideas. So what is UL doing right from a student life and from an HR kind of perspective? I've been delivering a variety of Trans 101 trainings. So I've trained student reps back in 2017, student life employees in August 2018. I hope to meet with the incoming sabbatical officers at the end of this summer. Lorcan O'Donnell is here, has been absolutely wonderful with his kind of working with me with the sabbatical officers, and I hope to kind of continue that really lovely relationship as we go forward. Gender-neutral toilets were established across campus in 2017. We've flown the Trans Pride flag a couple of times outside the President's Building, outside of the White House there, on Trans Day of Remembrance in 2018. It's flown a couple of times. Every time I see it, it makes me really happy. it's just kind of sending a message that, you know, we know there are trans students here on campus, and we are here to support them and fight in their corner, basically. It's quite a symbolic thing, and I recognize that it doesn't necessarily translate to any actual rights on campus, but having that symbolic acceptance is really, really nice. I'm an English student, I'm all about symbols. So, there was this incident in September 2018, right around the time I started doing these Trans 101 trainings, where there was this really unfortunate graffiti put on the door of a gender-neutral bathroom in the main building. It was pretty horrific. It was kind of one of those instances, and I think I'm quoted as saying this in a couple of the student newspapers, I didn't think these people existed offline. I thought these were kind of like, these trolls really were just kind of angry people that existed online. But there was a person that decided to deface the door and kind of actually scribble on the metal plate of this actual gender-neutral bathroom, and they wrote mental illness. And it was really unfortunate. It was in the psychology department. It was just this nasty kind of situation. But what I was really, really happy about, first of all, when I started reaching out to people, immediate response, just immediate. I mean, I was kind of fuming for a while before I sent the reports because I didn't know what to do and I was just really angry. You know, you get that anger stage first. And when I started finally sending things around, right away student life came up with just an unequivocal, we do not accept this kind of transphobia. This was horrible. We cannot, this is not what UL stands for. And that was so valuable to me. That was so, so affirming and really, really wonderful. We had a statement from the president's office as well, but he never used the words transphobic or hate crime or anything like that. So while I really, really appreciate that the president's office kind of went to that length of saying something and releasing a statement, I think more precise language was called for in that case. And I think in a way this is definitely tied to the fact that we don't have hate crime legislation in Ireland. So the UL kind of governing body didn't have any precedent to draw upon when saying, this is what we do for hate crimes. They just didn't, we don't have an idea. So we're kind of pushing forward and working our way through that one. We also have, through Athena Swan, which is kind of a gender equality watchdog organization that works with UL and higher education institutions across Ireland and the UK. I've been working with them lately, and they've established a subcommittee that's working to put together a gender identity and expression policy. We're working on it. It's come along miles and miles, and we're hoping to have it released as soon as humanly possible. It looks great. I'm really, really happy that it's there and that I get to kind of have my own voice represented on there. I think it's one of the most crucial things that a university should do. So I'm really excited that we're finally kind of getting that in place. From an academic point of view, we are a member of the Advanced Research Consortium on the topic of gender with NUIG. Through the gender arc, we also have kind of a queer reading group that we host as well. The gender arc can sometimes be a bit binary or a bit centering on women, I guess, which is really, really valuable and really, really important, but it doesn't always factor in that there are more than just men and women when we talk about gender. So it's been a really positive thing to have anyway. Of course, we have the Hate and Hostility Research Group and the report that was published in October 2017, and then that's already been mentioned by both of our lovely speakers. And we've hosted two really lovely international trans advocates so far, both in 2018, one in February, one in October, and we hope to host, you know, many, many more. I think it's, again, this is a symbolic kind of thing, right? Having trans speakers come and talk about their issues, and not necessarily just talking about being trans as well, but presenting their work and showing that, you know, trans people are robust in academic communities as well in terms of their own research, not necessarily always related to gender. I think it's just really important. And it's again, it's kind of a symbolic acceptance. So then what more do we do? How can we push forward? So this is a bit of a vague slide. I get a little bit more specific on my vision slide, but first of all, educate and empower. I want to see Trans 101 workshops as mandatory for all staff. Just put it right there. I would love to see it as mandatory for students too, but let's start with staff. I think it's incredibly, incredibly important, whether I give the training or somebody else does. I want these scheduled as much as possible because I think it's incredibly important. Students need to feel safe here, and students need to, you know, feel represented and feel comfortable being out and being, you know, kind of around campus. And this should be a safe space, basically. We shouldn't have to worry so much about hate crime here, right? So soon, of course, we're releasing the gender identity and expression policy. We're gonna get that out of the way, not out of the way, gonna get it published as soon as humanly possible, right? One of my big interesting things is that trans students and staff need seats at the table. Equity is more than just 50-50 gender representation, nothing for us without us, okay? So one of the things that Athena Swan is really, really, really strongly good at doing is saying we need 50-50 gender representation. It's so important. When I first started working with them, I kind of said, well, it could be 33, 33, and 33, and they were like, I would love to see that. I mean, I know that there are trans students and staff already here. We're just kind of in stealth mode, if that makes sense, because there's just not a lot of institutional kind of policies or support for us yet. We're working on it. So, I mean, just as related to the graffiti incident, I don't want to spend a whole lot of time on it. I know you can't read the student life text there, but it was just a picture of their statement. When we have hate crime incidences, especially relating to trans students, I have to be honest with you, I had never really gone into a gender-neutral toilet without seeing graffiti. And then my friend came from Montreal to study here this year to do an MA, and they were the ones that found the graffiti in that bathroom that I had mentioned. And because they saw it and they posted about it on Twitter, I was like, nobody hurts my friend. I was so disinclined to report it when it was just me, when I felt like it was just me seeing the thing, but when I knew somebody else was as well, I couldn't let it fly. So, we are here, and it would be nice if it was a kind of a comfortable place to be. As a tutor as well, because I'm a PhD student, they actually ask us to tutor. It's part of the scholarship that allows me to be here. Oftentimes when I talk about gender issues, when I talk about being trans, when I say I use they/them pronouns, I am very often subject to just these little microaggressions over and over and over again with students, with lecturers, with whatever, whatever. My supervisor still doesn't get my pronouns right, even though I've talked to her many, many times about it. We can be better. We can kind of make this a better place for us to be. So again, having that policy in place is really important, but also having a really clear reporting mechanism in place if there are instances of hate crime. So the reason, if I can say the reason I haven't actually pursued anything with my supervisor is because she'd know where it came from. She'd know who's saying, okay, you need to do this, and if she got disciplined, you know, there's nothing saying that she wouldn't be hard on me afterward because of it. I don't think she would be. She's a lovely person, whatever, whatever. But, you know, there has to be a policy in place. There has to be procedures. So, for these kind of hate speech kind of issues, there has to be policies in place for UL to address it together with student life, since it's a university-wide problem. It's not just a student life problem. It's definitely a bigger issue than that. So student life's response, excellent. President's response, not so much. So I want them to be on par. I want them to really work together. So things that are implemented in progress on one side and then to do on the other. So we'll start with implemented and in progress. Obviously the gender identity and expression policy. We are also working on facilitating name change process for students. At the moment, you need to have evidence of doing the deed poll procedure for having a name change, and then for living in that name for a certain number of years and all this fun stuff. I think that that is inherently classist, and it's just not really feasible for a lot of students to go ahead and change their name legally, but they'd like to have it changed in the university kind of system. So we need to make that a little easier. We are working on it. It's slow going, but I'm fighting as much as I can. I met with Plassey Campus Services, I think it was October of 2018, and I asked them if they would think about doing rainbow housing. So they've actually had 600 students apply for rainbow housing, and I am so delighted about this. It's exactly what it sounds like, right? It's just a space for LGBT students to have. It's a designated safe house in terms of on-campus accommodation. That was one of the things at my old university that we had. I was never part of it because it was so popular that I could never get a spot on the rainbow floor. But it was really, really lovely. It was kind of the community that you always wanted to be a part of. It was like the happy clique. They would have their own movie nights and things like that. It's just nice to have a community. It's nice to be able to think, like, okay, if I'm having trouble studying for this one thing, I can go and knock on somebody's door and they're not going to ask me questions about my gender right now. We're going to talk about homework that we have to be doing, right? One of the other things that we're working on that we're doing okay with is providing a write-in box for gender markers on applications and including gender-neutral titles and honorifics like mix. I've been able to change my honorific to mix on the student, one of the many portals. I don't actually know what it's called, but I've been able to change it. So it is possible. We're slowly eking towards that, but it's taking a little while. One of the first things that I came to student life with a couple of years ago when I first started here at UL was, look, I had to apply and it was male, female, nothing, right? And I had to tick a box and right away I felt like I was kind of not welcome, right? So having paperwork that doesn't necessarily other us right away would be very, very useful. We are kind of, it's in development, but it's one of those things that takes a little bit of time to really be implemented. So to do, one of the biggest things that I really, really want is to create a designated safe space on campus. And that is literally to have a room with, you know, couches, armchairs, whatever, bowl of condoms on a coffee table, a library of LGBT related books, and somebody who sits in that room every day, right? And if students want to come in and hang out and have a safe space to hang out, they can. If students want to then schedule kind of a one-on-one meeting with somebody, they can. There's a place for them to go to talk about gender issues, to talk about sexuality issues, to talk about maybe even, you know, domestic violence kind of issues, everything kind of surrounding health in general in that kind of way. So I think that that's really, really important. Again, I'm using as a reference point my alma mater in the States, and they had this kind of place. And it was just a big room with a lot of couches and armchairs, and it was just a nice place to go and have lunch most of the time for me. But they always had somebody there that you could go and talk to and be like, look, I don't actually understand what's the difference between genderqueer and non-binary. I don't really get it. Could you tell me what the difference is? And they would always be willing to talk to you. They also hosted these monthly safe zone trainings where everybody from the university was welcome, students, staff, lecturers, whatever, was welcome, and they came and had sort of like the seminar that you had this morning, the LGBT kind of 101 awareness kind of trainings, right? And when you graduated from that, you got a little safe zone sticker and you could put it in your office so that your office becomes a safe zone. But having a designated space as well is really, really important. So again, I think Safe Zone and Trans 101 trainings for all staff is absolutely 100% non-negotiable, necessary. And I ask, I'm not sure how I'm going to go about this, but I want to ask staff to include pronouns in email signatures. It's something that I do, it's something that some people also do. I think it's just a nice way of kind of saying, even if you are cisgender, normalizing the pronoun process, normalizing asking people for pronouns so that you're not misgendering somebody right away, if that makes sense. I think it's really a very important kind of thing. I think that's about what I wanted to say on that. Again, in the safe space and getting a designated staff person, I'm not necessarily talking about in a counseling role. I have para-counseling there, because para-counseling is like counseling light, right? It's just something that you can have a good conversation with, somebody that will listen to you and is educated on LGBT issues. I know the counseling service here is very, very good. They're very, very overtaxed. They're very, very overwhelmed. And in my experience, they don't have the most awareness around LGBT issues. They do have some, and I know they're trying really hard, but it's just not always there. And to speak very personally, when I'm going to a counseling service, I need, you know, care and attention, and I don't really want to spend a whole hour talking about my gender identity because of a thing that I put down on the form, right? I want to spend the hour talking about this thing that I'm having a crisis about, right? It's just kind of a different set of things. So having like a liaison officer, like we talked about with the Garda, having somebody specifically that students could go to if they're having issues and need to have a chat about it. I've been doing this informally for years, but I feel kind of overstretched because I feel like there's a lot of students that I don't reach, right? So I think having a designated staff person would be really, really important. So why bother, why now? I think it's mostly just important that we need to send a message to existing and potential trans students and staff that we're willing to be inclusive, we're willing to stand up for rights and comfort no matter what it takes. I think Ireland need not only have one safe city for gender diversity. I think a lot of times everybody tends to flow to Dublin, flow to kind of the metropolitan areas, and Limerick has a particularly not great reputation for LGBT students and for hate crime, for all this kind of stuff. I want it to be better. This is my personal project. I think Limerick can and will be a really wonderful place for LGBT people to be and exist and thrive. We have, gosh, for goodness sakes, we have the structure in place. We just need to keep working on it. And I think having UL become a safer space is central to that. And I always think it's really interesting. I ran out and bought this thing 4 years ago. It's the transgender tipping point. Everything's gonna get better for us. It was 4 years ago. And actually in the US, things are quite retrogressive at the moment. So if we've had our tipping point, if we've had this point where, you know, we're more out than we have ever been, we're more visible than we have ever been, what's the holdup? We should maybe be a little further along. So in terms of resources then, these are resources for educators, for anybody that's involved with UL in general. I would highly, highly recommend, obviously, Tenny and Gosh, for sure. Out in UL has been a wonderful resource. They are our LGBT society here on campus. They're wonderful. If you need other educational resources, the last two are quite US-based, but I find them useful nonetheless. It's the Gay and Lesbian Student Educational Network, GLSEN, and the Trans Student Educational Resources.org. That's also quite useful. I also have books. I'm trying to grow my own trans library, and it's been a little bit difficult. I'm a PhD student, I don't have much money, but I'm slowly chipping away and getting these books. There is a wealth of, just a wonderful wealth of books by trans people, for trans people, about gender identity and about exploring that. So if in particular we're looking at in the university, Z. Nicolazzo's Trans in College and Trans Policies and Experience in Housing and Residence Life, highly, highly recommend. Z is a non-binary trans person. Really, really wonderful resource. Dr. Ben Vincent's Transgender Health and Practitioner's Guide, again, this is more geared towards GPs. I haven't read this one yet, but I'm looking forward to it because I think it's something that's very needed. And then the last four are more along the lines of autobiography, but these are all really wonderful so far. So Sian Lester's Trends Like Me, Laura Kate Dale's Uncomfortable Labels, Jacob Tobias' System, and Meg John Barker and Alex Ann Taffy's Life Is Not Binary. For questioning students, again, we don't have as much on campus as I would like. It's in progress. I think what I would like to do as the student council rep, I'd like to introduce a motion to the student council this year, because it's my last year, to either allocate a space, like I was saying, or to allocate a designated staff member. So I have to decide which of those I'm going to go with first, or if I'm going to attack both, or what's going to happen here. But hopefully big things will be happening in the next year. For questioning students, any of those books I recommended would be excellent. Send them to Tenny, send them to Gosh, send them to OutMeWell, send them to me. I have business cards that I can pass out afterward if you're interested. And these two books have personally really, really helped me when I've had questions about my own kind of gender stuff. Gender Outlaws is an anthology of essays and creative kind of texts put together by two trans people for trans people, and it's just really lovely and affirming. And then My New Gender Workbook is literally this really, really fascinating thing. So how do I feel about my gender today? How do I like to describe how I feel in my body today? What are some words that I can use? And it's like a maths workbook, and you just fill it out. And it's really, really interesting. You know, you can do one every couple of years, see how things have changed. It's fascinating. It's a really valuable resource. I have PDFs of both of those if anybody would like them. And of course, my own information, shameless self-plug. I do these Trans 101 workshops and trainings. I've done two so far in the last academic year, and I'm scheduled to do about six more across June and September. The email just came in today. I'm so excited. So come along if you can. Recommend them as highly as you can. I want more people to be attending these things. It's really, really important to me personally, and I think to the university community as well. I'm also starting to work with secondary and primary schools, giving Trans 101 kind of workshops to them as well. So that's slowly getting off the ground. It's kind of a favor to a friend at the moment. But if that's something that you would be interested in, let me know. Thank you very, very much for listening.